everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we are in a bright August morning. You may have remembered from last month we took on what's blooming in our garden in July. Well, now that it's August, we can do what's blooming in August. We have 53 different plants that are blooming right now, so we'd like to quickly take a little run through and show you what we have. I have a list. So the first on the list is the Asiatic lily. Now these look somewhat like what people call ditch lilies, but they're not. I planted these. They are bulbs that I planted years ago, and thankfully they have spread slightly. But that's wonderful. Second on the list is bachelor buttons. Now this year, in the little holes that were left when Rick did the fabric, I decided we'll put flowers in here. And the bachelor buttons are the bluish purple ones and the pink ones. There's some pink ones. They are self-seeding. They're not perennials. Next on the list are balloon flowers. Now these have gone crazy this year. I mean, I have hoops keeping them standing upright because these are the tall ones, but they are just amazingly full of blossoms. Now, if I don't want them scattered everywhere, these will have to be cut off, but I'm waiting till I can do many of them at the same time.
I'd say you have at least 300 here.
At least, yes.
And the pollinators love them.
They do love them. Sometimes you get things growing in your garden that you have not planted and you don't want, and that would be bindweed. This is bindweed. It's in the Morning Glory family. We've spoken about it many times. It takes over. It binds all over everything. This has little pink Morning Glory flowers because the flower itself is probably this big and it's pink. We have pulled so much and we've been trying to keep on top of it. Right now we don't have any that's blooming. Yay us.
It was though.
But it was. Number five on our list is a black-eyed Susan. Not sure if these are perennial or not, but they drop their seeds, so the seeds themselves could also just be a way to reproduce them. Very beautiful, very sturdy plant. Number six, bugbane. What an ugly name that is, but it's an interesting plant. This whole area came from one little clump. So it spreads quite rapidly. This is the seed head after it's blossomed. The beginning of the month it was blossoming, now it isn't. So each of these is a seed that if you drop it on the ground, you'll get some more. It also spreads by roots.
Well, you did a lot of deadheading in the last couple of days as well. So.
Yeah, and there's a reason. So if you want this, and it's a unique plant because it has the neatest blossoms on it, but put it in a place where you don't care if it spreads out a little bit, because it will.
Could be a little invasive.
Number seven, calendula. Now, if you like a happy, bright flower that goes on and it seeds itself, this yellow and orange grouping has seeded itself here. And there
and everywhere.
There and there and there and there. So
and
it
there
will,
and there and there.
It will, and that's because if you just look at this, these are the seeds. And they readily fall off and they plant themselves. California poppies. Now these aren't the big ones that you see that leave that have the really cool head that they get poppy seed from. These are the smaller ones, and this is the seed pod to these. So I planted these this year in this container, and they took quite a long while to get going, but now they're going and they are having a ball. Number nine is canna, and these are the red leaf cannas. These are tender bulbs. You have to take them in if you want to keep them year to year and keep them in your basement, but they are impressive. And if you look over my shoulder, you'll see several more along the driveway, as well as here.
And we have more behind the waterfall.
We do. And they're worth the wait for having them come up. And even if they didn't bloom, the foliage is beautiful. Number 10 is a native. It's called compass plant, and you've heard us talk about that before. It has oriented itself north and south, and now it's in bloom. So while the plant itself isn't that large, the flowering head goes up 12 to 14 feet. So you need some space for it, and I have tried to put it on a pole so it doesn't go down, but I need a 12-foot pole.
Maybe
so
we'll have to put one of those shepherd hooks over here.
Yeah, maybe. Huh? But as you can see, the bees and the love it. The pollinators love it. And I would just say, if you're going to grow this, get the seed heads before they start dropping seeds, or you will have these everywhere.
They are everywhere.
Number 11 is coneflower or echinacea. Some people use echinacea for health reasons. This is the
Salsa red,
which I bought as a plant, and it has just gone crazy here, and I'm so happy because even as they fade, they're still beautiful. This is the purple one. Now this bloomed first. It gets tall, and I'm leaving the heads on because there are seeds in there and the birds do like them. And perhaps they will seed themselves as they get older and older, but they will come back up from the roots.
This one was really nice and purple a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah. Yep, it's faded, but
yeah. Well, there's okay. Another one.
Yes, there are. This is the double pink. And even as it grows older and older, it's still beautiful. I mean, it's just lovely. And they bloom for a long time, so you can use them as cut flowers, they'll come back. And here's the white variety. And you can see pollinators love them. And they're so majestic. Look at that really big one there. That's really cool.
I know native coneflowers, their leaves and flowers droop, which this one is doing.
Yes, but I wouldn't call this a native, though, because the heads are so much bigger.
Huh. Okay.
Number 12, coral bells. And the variety of coral bells is amazing. This is a beautiful coral bell. Carnival coffee.
Bean.
And then there's this one.
This is a marvelous marvel. It's not blooming right now.
Right.
Then you got the purples.
These are I'm trying to think what they're called.
I thought you called those the purple leaf.
Oh, no. Here we go. This is wild berry coral bells. But you can look over here and you see there's a variety here and here and here.
Well, then you have all the coral bells on the southwest corner of our home, but that area has been so dry, I hate to say it, but they look rather pathetic.
Yes, but they'll come back once they're watered by either me or
Mother Nature.
This is cosmos. Now, it's not the kind of cosmos that I'm used to that are taller and they have pink and different colors. This was an orange one. And it's lovely, but it's not what I expected. And again, I had to seed these. These were not perennials, and they weren't a plant I bought. This particular area, which we'll get to when we talk about zinnias, I had to plant multiple times, either because of birds eating the seed, or slugs, or just they didn't come up. Plenty of times I planted them. Number 14 is another interesting plant. This is called the cup plant, and you can see that the leaves form a cup, so when it rains, it stores the water in there and the plant can use it. Normally, this would be 6 feet tall. So you can see, because of the weather, not enough rain, it's stunted but still blossoming.
Well, we're still at least 6 inches under.
Yes. Here's a purple that's actually blossoming right now. Beautiful. and many more to come. They last a long time in the blossoming state, so they're great for cut flowers. And here's a purple one. Now this one did blossom earlier in the summer, but only one blossom, and now is when it should be blossoming. So that'll be beautiful. We'll show you a different one. And a red one. Also glorious. Now if you cut off the old ones that have done, it'll encourage more blossoms to blossom, which is always good. Number 16 is daisies, and this is the second go-around for these. I chopped all of them back, pulled them out. We had two trailer loads full that we took to the recycling center, and the ones that I chopped are, of course, re-blooming. That's what they do. So if you want a second bloom of daisies, you cut down the first to probably this deep, this tall, and they'll start again. Number 17 is forget-me-nots, and although they were blooming at the beginning of the month, they started getting a lot of seeds, and I didn't want all of those seeds in this garden because this is where we have vegetables, so I cut them back, but you can see they're starting over again. And the reason that I planted them, the reason I'm letting them start over, is because our niece's husband's mother passed away, and they passed these seeds out. And it was a beautiful
remembrance
for her. So we included it, even though you can't see them right now. Number 18 is fragrant gladiolus. Now, who knew that gladiolus could be fragrant, and they don't even look anything like a gladiola? Let me see if they're fragrant. Slightly. But they are an interesting plant, and again, you have to dig these up and store them, right, store them for the winter. They're very easy to keep for the entire winter. They don't take any problem at all, and they're usually very successful for them to come back. Number 19 is helenium. Now, in the past, this has been 6 feet tall. It was huge and covered with these blossoms, hundreds of pollinators on it. For whatever reason, this year it's smaller. The center of the root ball seems to be in a circle, missing in the circle. So
it's like the crown is gone.
Right. So I think we'll probably dig this one up and reposition things and check the roots come fall. Number 20 through number 25 are the hardy hibiscus. And you can see that they are very prolific, and they're very awesome when you look at them, especially all together.
It's an explosion of blossoms.
The first hibiscus is Cranberry Crush, one of my very favorites. Number 21 is the giant white hardy hibiscus. This is the one that started it all. We got this from Manchez Farms. Fell in love with it, couldn't believe hibiscus grew in our climate, and from there we just went on a search for a variety.
Well, yeah. We have dug this up so many times and put
times.
Them around the property.
Right, you can divide them, root divide them. Sometimes they'll even seed themselves, but you see this and you think, oh no, they're done already. Well, no, this is just done for today. This is a seed. Like I said, sometimes they start growing from it, sometimes not. And some of them, I think, have been hybridized to the point where they're sterile and they don't grow from seed anymore. But each day, you can see, each day a new one will be blossoming to replace the ones that already blossomed.
This was the one from yesterday. So, and they just end up dropping on the ground.
They are kind of messy, but it's worth it.
Kind of reminds me of magnolia.
Jazzberry Jam is number 22. I mean, and just look at how differently they're colored, but they're beautiful in their own way. They're just lovely. Kind of hard to use them as a cut flower because obviously they don't last long, but they would be beautiful.
Well, it's impressive. I mean, this one started last month already.
Yes, it did. Number 23 is a shorter version. This is the Luna family of them. And they have been hybridized and propagated, and there are so many varieties now, I don't even know how many.
But this is a Luna pink swirl.
Yes, and it's, you can see the swirl and the beautiful red inside. Gorgeous. So if you have a smaller space, this would be a great one. Number 24 is Luna Rose. Again, it's a shorter version. This one was from yesterday. As you can see, it's kind of faded away, probably the day before. And here's the new one. Oh, so beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Number 25 is Midnight Marvel. And this one was the first one to bloom this year. Again, cute, just absolutely gorgeous.
I mean, there are dozens and dozens and dozens of blossoms.
And every time you see this, you know that's how many more are coming. And thank goodness this year we have not had a lot of Japanese beetles, because the Japanese beetles do like to chew on the blossom itself.
This has to be close to 6 foot tall.
Well, we didn't give these numbers because we don't know what they are. This is another absolutely gorgeous one.
It's like a ruffled leaf.
Yes. And if one of you viewers knows what this one is, we would truly appreciate help on this one. But then here's another one. We thought this was
a Luna Rose.
A Luna Rose, but obviously it's too tall. And it reseeded itself. So that's what it looks like. Number 26 is Honeysuckle. Now we have a couple of varieties of them, and this one started the end of July and it still goes on. A favorite for pollinators, although I don't see any at the moment.
Especially for hummingbirds. I've seen a lot of hummingbirds.
Yes.
Over here.
Well, it's perfectly built for a hummingbird because it has, yeah, that long
trumpet
type that they can stick their little beak in.
Proboscis or whatever they call it.
27 is, I believe, a native plant, and it's called Hoary Skullcap. What a name is that? But beautiful blossoms. It gets tall. I do have it staked, but it even pulled over my stake. 28 is a Strawberry Sunday Hydrangea that is, you can tell as it turns pink why they call it that. So, and it has that nice kind of a pyramid-shaped head on it, and they last a long time. And if you want to save them for dried flowers, you pick them and you kind of hang them upside down for a while. 29 is a hydrangea tree. That means that as it grew, they formed it into a tree by chopping away all the bottom parts and let it go. But you can see what else is growing in here. Bindweed. Oh, bindweed.
Here, give it to me.
I will. Let me get some more.
It loves to take over. Gotta love morning glories.
Well,
don't you, Tim?
They are a prolific family.
Now, I know, Tim, sure, you're not responsible for these.
Though. No, he isn't.
So,
don't,
I'm
even
just
blame
kidding
him. Again, just gorgeous. And if you want, like I said, if you want to keep them for winter as a dried flower, just cut them off, hang them upside down for a little bit, and they'll be beautiful all winter.
Like a dried flower.
Yeah. Number 30 is thanks to Scott and Sarah Miller. They like Joe Pieweed, and that is this huge bush. Again, or plant, I should say. It's not as tall as it usually is, again, probably because of the dryness. But obviously also lots of heads and lots of pollinators.
Well, it's close to 6 foot tall.
Yeah, well, I think it usually gets a little taller. Number 31 is Lantana, and this is thanks to our neighbor Ginger Becker, who once let me babysit for her flower over the summer, and it laid seeds everywhere. And it came in that color and also the pale pink color. Number 32 is Liatris. Now, if you've watched any of our videos, you've seen Liatris. It is one of my all-time favorites. It is hardy. It is a favorite with pollinators. And in the fall, all of these little old flowers will be seeds, and you just run your hand up and you have a whole handful of seeds, and then you can sprinkle them wherever you want.
Such
and
as?
I do. Yes, look behind me. Mm-hmm. Now there's also a white variety, which we also have, but that one's pretty much done for now. But it's a very happy plant, and it's beloved by bumblebees.
Well, these were in their full glory at the beginning of the month.
Exactly.
And now they're starting to work their way down.
They're going to seed.
Yeah.
As you can see, here's what the seeds look like.
I remember one year you had a whole shopping bag full of seeds. Yeah.
Come on, make some more.
You just put it on the grass.
That's all right. They'll come up.
Oh, thanks a lot.
Now, this is a interesting plant that our friend and viewer Phyllis Fox sent to us a couple of years ago, and it didn't do anything until this year. Where now yesterday it was in full bloom. It's orange and it's spotted, and it's called a orange spotted blackberry lily. Very, very cool.
It was beautiful yesterday. Wow. Very impressive.
I did take a picture of it.
Yes.
But thanks, Phyllis. Number 34 is marigold. Marigolds, we all know, are about this tall. They're either yellow or they're orange, or they're orange and yellow mixed together. But our friend Dee grew some whoppers. Look at these. They're absolutely huge.
These are close to 3 foot tall, maybe even taller.
Yeah, and she said these were called Cracker Jack marigolds. She started them inside, brought us 10 of them, and we decided to put them on the inside of our berm. You can just, I mean, they pop out. You can see them very easily. Lovely. And the more you trim them off, the more it encourages new blooms. Number 35 is Mexican sunflower. Now, we saw these and planted them probably 2 years ago and fell in love with them and shared the pictures of them to the point where some of our neighbors and relatives said, oh, get me some seeds for that. We know they had them at Menards. This one I started in the house earlier in the spring. Then I planted these directly into the container. Now this one obviously got much taller, but this one is blossoming more than this one so far.
Well, here you only have 2 blossoms so far.
And again, I cut the blossoms off when they're done, and it just encourages more. Now if you look through that sunflower, you'll see there's another really tall one back there. Lovely.
That is amazing. I mean, that is a strong stem structure.
Yes.
Wow.
And it's not a perennial, so in this climate we have to reseed them every year. Number 36 is called a mammoth mum. It's not your regular mum that they say are hardy mums. This is a mammoth mum that is a perennial, even in this climate. Now, they say hardy mums are, but they're not. The mammoth mum comes back and it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Now I planted a smaller one that's being dwarfed now by the big one, and I think this one is going to be pink. They do come in different colors and different styles. One is a daisy and this is a different variety because of the way the flower is.
Well, you planted another one on the south side of the waterfall.
Yes, that one is also orange. Beautiful. Number 37, moss roses. These you plant every year. Sometimes they will reseed themselves and come back. They come in a variety of colors. This one looks like it's just all going to be red, but they're beautiful. They remind me of like little succulents or something, mm-hmm. because they have the little pointy fat leaves on them. But the flowers are gorgeous. And if you were Richard, you'd call them Ross Moses. Number 38 is the native coneflower, native echinacea. This is the one Rick was referring to before, where the petals are really drooping down. This is how they are. And the cone part is very prolific. These seeds that are in here are food for the birds. They love these. And it gives them food for fall and winter.
Especially the yellow finch. I mean,
yes,
they're
the
all
yellow
over
finches
this.
Love them. And they will move. So if you don't want them to move, then you'll cut them down and the birds will just have to get something else to eat. Number 39 is a native as well, and this is Northern Wild Senna. Now, when we first bought it, it was labeled as giant Indian plantain, I believe. But on further research, Rick found that this is exactly what it is. And we're lucky to get it today, because I will be chopping all these blossoms off, as I do not want Northern Senna all over this area. Number 40 is another native plant. This is called Prairie Dock. And the interesting thing about this is the leaves. You can see how textured they are. They're like sandpaper. This side is smoother. But when you put your hand on either side of the leaf, no matter how hot it is outside, the leaves are cool. And that's because the roots go down 12 to 14 feet where it's cool. Another thing about it is the flower stalk goes up at least 12 feet.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yep. Here you go.
I mean, it's up into the apple tree.
Right. Now, caution. If you don't want these all over your garden, like right over there, you'll see a number of them right there. They will, if the situation is right, they will plant new seeds wherever they want.
Are literally everywhere on our
property. We got them along the driveway. I have dug many up and given them away. You just stepped on one.
Yes, I did.
So if you don't want them everywhere, then you just take them down before they go to seed.
Good luck with that.
Number 41 is in the rose mallow family. This was in a package of wildflower seeds. And when I saw it, I was just like, wow, what is that? And then I found out it is in the rose mallow family, just like all the hibiscus. Now, while these are kind of a reddish and a pink, we also have growing in our garden just pink ones that come up every year. They seed themselves, they have deep roots. So they are valuable if you like them. Number 42, Rose of Sharon. These are gorgeous. These I believe are in the hibiscus family.
Mm-hmm.
And there are two bushes here, which we didn't realize when we planted them. We have the pure white one and we have the white with the red. Across the street, our neighbor has a blue one that is absolutely gorgeous.
I'm going to be looking for that one next year.
Uh-huh. Very easy. They grow well without any help at all. This one should get more sun. Doesn't even seem to bother that it doesn't. Number 43 is Royal Catchfly. This one we bought years ago. I planted it. Didn't do anything. Forgot about it. And then suddenly, I believe last year, it showed up, and it's very pretty.
It's very like lovely. A star.
Yes.
Five petal.
Yep. It's very interesting.
I see you have another one over there.
Mm-hmm. So obviously they move themselves with seeds. Number 44 is called Smartweed, and it likes to take over, so put it in a place where it has room to grow. We planted this one because it seems to attract the Japanese beetles. And you can see when they were here for the day or two, they were after it. They will strip that whole, all the leaves. Every leaf will be skeletonized.
Flower, everything.
And that's how we know when the Japanese beetles are here, but they're not chewing on these because they like these better. Number 45, snapdragons. Again, one of my favorite flowers. I planted them once. Oh, and now they're everywhere. And they're absolutely marvelous. And what the kids always like to do and what my dad showed us is they open like a snapping dragon.
Kind of reminds me of you talking to me.
Hey, and then these seeds, the seed pods, when you see them in the fall after they've turned brown, they look like a little skull. I couldn't believe when I saw a picture of one time and I said, our snapdragons don't look like that. They do. They're everywhere too. It's lovely. Number 46 is spirea, which is a bush. And 5 years ago when we had the house resided, we had to take everything that was in here out and we replaced them with these bushes, which were tiny. And every year Rick trims them back. And
full of blossoms, yes. Earlier this month. I mean, loaded.
They're still around,
yeah.
But they'll go on and on for a while. Nice. Number 47, sunflowers. 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 And more sunflowers. Number 48, sweet pea. Now I planted these once. Beware. They seed and come back.
Everywhere.
Number 49, trumpet vine. Beware.
This is up into our tree.
It's up in the tree. It's all over that bush there. It's all over the ground. Beware. They're beautiful.
Those vines are all over.
Mm-hmm. Number 50 is water lilies and their friends. I'd say we probably have had at least a dozen water lilies open. They stay open for a few days. And then they're done. And then a new one opens. They've been white, yellow,
pink,
rosy color, and pink. All different colors. Number 51 is reblooming wigelia, or wigelia, however you pronounce it. We trimmed it after the first blossom, and now this one is reblooming. Number 52 is yarrow. Yeah, we talked about this last month, and they still go on. And these are the multicolored ones. I never knew there were multicolor until this year. This bright red one is very pretty. They look great in a bouquet.
And they were amazing last month when we featured them as mm-hmm. well, so I'm amazed they're still going.
Yes. Number 53, last but not least, zinnias. And like I said before, we had to plant these at least 3 times. And then I also, when some came up and others didn't, I transplanted them, some of them, to a different space. But it was worth the wait. The pollinators love them. There's such a variety of colors and shapes. And I mean, they're just gorgeous. I love them. But guess what? Oh. Sunflowers. Thank you, birds. Now, you may have seen a plant or two that's blossoming that we didn't mention. If you found those plants, please let us know. It's a little test. We're not done yet. Probably in mid-July, we started harvesting some of our vegetables and our fruits. We had raspberries. We now have blackberries. And we also had tomatoes. What can I say about tomato berries?
Well, you've had cucumbers.
And cucumbers.
Zucchini.
And zucchinis and spaghetti squash. But we also wanted to show you the fruit trees because these have been growing for several years now. And last year was the first year that this Anjou pear tree actually had pears. We didn't even know what this was anymore. We lost the label to it, and this one's going to be ready to eat today, Richard. Ooh.
Now, do I get any, or are you going to gobble it down yourself?
It depends. If you treat me nicely, I'll give you some.
Oh, thank you.
Years and years and years ago, we planted this Bartlett pear tree. Obviously didn't know how to trim it, and it got way out of control. Last year, this was loaded with pears. I mean, they were falling, dropping like flies all over the ground.
Hundreds.
Hundreds. This year, there's maybe a couple dozen.
Well, the same with this apple tree.
Yes, this mystery apple tree right here. That last year was full of them. Now there's a couple.
And
they
the same,
very tasty, though.
The same with the two Macintosh we have along the driveway for the high school kids.
Exactly. But we do have more apples. Blackberry vines. They are so prolific this year. I tried chopping them, trying to keep them under control. Obviously, they are in control and not I, but our neighbor Josh loves them, so he gets them. We're not real fond of them ourselves.
They are healthy.
They are healthy. Now we're in the orchard. This is our Alberta freestone peach tree that we got from Fast Growing Trees. This is more in the shade of the spruce tree. And so the peaches at this point are still green and hard. Lots of them. Yay. Can hardly wait.
But
we have baby peaches that grew from two of our former peaches. This is one of the babies.
I mean, this is loaded with probably over 100 peaches in here.
Oh, at least, yes.
And this tree is only 3 years old.
Yes. And these, while they're turning orange already, well, this one, maybe. Look at that. That is a gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous.
And that's the good old Georgia peach.
It is. And freestone means you can cut it in half and the seed will pop out. You don't have to try cutting around the pit.
Now, what's amazing about this tree, that peach tree, and three of the peach trees behind me on the outside of this orchard area were grown from seed that were dropped from our two original peach trees.
Correct.
That were on the south side of our pergola.
Yes.
And about 5 years after we had cut them down, guess, lo and behold, what did we find?
New trees started growing.
And this tree, 3 years ago, was 12 inches tall, as were all of them that we planted. And yet, this tree has more peaches on it than the peach trees we have purchased.
Yes.
So, I'm happy.
We are happy. But then if we turn around and look at our 5-in-1 apple tree. Last year we had a few. This year we have many more.
Now this is grown, or five different varieties are grafted
right
to the
Granny Smith
woodstock itself. And then you have four other species, which are?
We got Braeburn, we've got Gala, we have Fuji, and Honeycrisp. And I said Gala, right?
I think so.
Yeah, okay. So Granny Smith, Braeburn, Fuji, Gala, and Honeycrisp.
Now Granny Smith is really good for pies and things like that, right?
Yes. It's more sour and tart. And the other ones have their own sweetness. Last year we had a lot of Braeburns. This year I see we have a lot of different kinds. And here's another tree again. This one gets more sun on this side. Not so much on this side, so these are getting red before the others.
Well, nice to have apples from your garden.
Yes.
I have to give a shout out to Rim's Edge.
Oh, Rim's Edge.
If you are ever in the, greater Milwaukee area, and you're looking for delicious apples, he's got over 6,000 apple trees, at least he did last year. We came home with I forget how many bushels of apples.
Right. So look them up, Rim's Edge Apple Orchard.
Yeah, amazing.
We hope you're still with us after all this time. I know we're getting tired just walking around talking.
What do you mean tired? I'm hungry.
Well, that too. You're a growing boy. If you did, we'd appreciate it if you would give us a thumbs up. That is just wonderful when we see those thumbs up, and we love your comments and your questions and your tips. Also, if you're not part of our subscribing family and you'd like to be part of our garden family, please hit that little subscribe button over here somewhere. And then you may want to look up and you'll see a bell, and that bell will change colors when we have a new video.
Well, it'll notify you, but you have to request being notified of new videos.
There you go.
And how many videos do you have so far?
Oh my goodness, I don't even know. It's over 1,000, I know that much.
And they're all family friendly.
I can't believe that. And if you'd like to see a list of them and go visit some more, go to wisconsingarden.com and you'll see everything. And if you have questions or if you want to see a particular video, you can go to the A through Z portion, and it will tell you by topic what the tour, what the video is about.
Well, you do have to request that secret link. And so all you have to do is email lynn@wisconsingarden.com, and we will send you the secret link that will give you access, instant access, I should say, to over 1,000 videos.
And that's helpful if you have a question about one specific thing and you don't want to have to go through all of them yourself. But thank you again for watching. Our hearts and our thoughts are out to the people who have had floods and tornadoes and
Hawaii, the devastation of that.
You are in our thoughts and our prayers. Be safe. Keep the love growing. Bye for now.
Do I get to eat now?
Yes.
Connect with us on YouTube and subscribe to our channel.